Hi all, welcome to Selenium WebDriver training session with Java, session 8. So today in this session, I will try to cover what is the input and output operations of Java, what does it mean by immutable string in Java, and how we can update the string with the help of string buffer class, and what is the importance of this keyword and finally keyword in Java. So first, session will be covered what does it mean by file in Java. So you know whenever you want to create an Excel file, text file, or maybe Word document or PPT, you have to first definitely create a folder, or in case you are having some folder, then after that you can create your own file and you can write some word on that, or you can write some content on that particular file. And in case if you want to update it, you can do it. You can, if you want to read the file, you can also do it, And if you want to make the file with the read-only mode, you can also do it, So Java also provides all the important methods to handle with the file, There are many ways to read a file in Java. We can use buffer reader, file reader, or file class. Similarly, with the help of file writer, buffer writer, files, or file output stream, we can write in the file. Write means obviously we are writing something in the file. And reading means whatever content is available in the file, we will try to read it. File class provides method to get file permission details as well as change them. These are the important methods available in the file class. If you want to first create a file, you have to use make directory, that method. If you want to create a new file, you have to use create new file, If you want to read the file, you can use can read. It will test whether the file is readable or not. Similarly, with the help of can write, you can verify whether the file is writable or not. That means the file is only read only, or also you are able to write it or not. If you want to delete the file or folder structure, you can use delete. If you want to check the whether the file is existing in the particular location or not, you can use the exist method. Similarly, if you want to get the name of the file or get the absolute of the file, you can use these two methods. And these are the different type, return type. So can read, can write, create a new file, delete, exist, and make directory, it will give you booleans, Whether it is creating or not, whether it is readable or writable or not. Similarly, for the length, it will be long, It can be 1000 line as well, so length will be increasing. Similarly, for the get name and get absolute path, it's definitely string, It will give you path, so it will be string, So I will show you first how we can maintain a folder. Folder means we can create a folder. We can check whether the folder is created or not. Similarly, we can delete a folder, So how we can create a folder? So here in the Selenium training package, I am creating a class here for session 8. And I am definitely selecting public static void main. So in the session 8, so this is the syntax, for creating a file, we have to use file. This is the class already available in Java. And we have to create an object, for creating the object of the file, equal to new file. And here we need to give the some path, If you want to create some file, or if you want to create some text, some document inside the file, we have to give the path, So suppose I want to create a file in my D drive, So I am clicking on the my computer. And in the D drive, if I want to click something, say suppose in the D drive I want to create some file, So I'll be placing that path here within the particular double quote, and here you need to give the file name, Suppose I want to give any create any file name called Selenium. Yes.
I lost your voice. Everything you were writing something online, but I lost your voice.
So I will be telling it that whenever if you want to create some file, you have to use that particular file class available in Java, And then you have to create an object or instance, then new file, and in that particular double bracket you have to give the some file name, So here in my D drive I want to create some file, so I have given the path of the D drive, and here you can see no file is available, that name. But I want to create a file, Selenium training, online training, So that's file I want to create with the help of Java. So you can see here some error message is coming. So we need to import the file class, available in Java from the java.io package. So once the import is successful, you can see it is, I mean, no error message is there, only warning message is there, because we are not creating using that particular object or instance, right? Or right. So now if you want to create a file, right? So I already mentioned, right, you have to use that particular method, right? Make directory to create a directory or files, right? So I'll be using that object reference, then dot make directory, right? You can see here, make directory. So that particular file will be created in the D drive. So this is the D drive. In the D drive, where that particular folder is not available, it will create, right? And if you run your code, you can see here that particular file will be created, right? Now Selenium Online Training, there is no such file available in my D drive, right? Now I want to create a file with the help of Java. So if you run here, you can see that file will be created. Obviously no output will be there because we did not write any output here, but if you refresh your page, you can see the Selenium Training Online Training file has been created, but nothing was available, just we have created the file, right? Now say let's remove the file, okay? And after creating the file, if you don't want to validate from your path, but if you want to validate from your screen, right, that you can validate it. So with the help of file keyword, file object oriented, after creating the file, so I want to validate whether file is exist or not. So it will be exist, right? You can see here file exist, file dot exist, that is the method we can use it, right? Okay, so here you can see I already mentioned it. For verifying the file, we can use the exist method, right? It will be returned in boolean, right? So I'll be storing some boolean variable. Data type is a boolean, and suppose I am giving a variable name is b1, okay? So it will, I want to validate whether it's true or not. Once the file is created, so obviously it will be true, right? And suppose if I want to print out the,
okay, what is the need of creating that line of code file.exe?
So that I can check whether the file has been created or not, right? After creating the file, so file.exist will give you some boolean value, right? True or false, okay? Because return type, you can see here, right, that the type is boolean, so it will either give you true or false. So after creating the file, if you want to check, right, whether the file has been exist or not, means file has been created or not, right? So in case it is giving you true, so you can validate easily from your console itself that file has been created. I will not go to the particular folder. Got it? Okay. So let's try to create it. Right now I have deleted the file, right? So no file is available for Java online training. Now let's try to run it and let's see what is the output. Okay, output is coming as true because file exists now. After creating the file, it is exist, right? And okay, so that is the reason it is coming as true. And if you go to the D drive, you can see here that particular file is has been created. Now if you want to check that particular file name as Selenium Online Training 1, right? So that will create here, right? Now again, if you want to check it, it will give you result, right? But let's say I am not creating anything. Okay, so I am not creating, right? So now I want to check that particular path. In the particular path, I am checking with that particular object, and now with that object I want to check whether that particular file is available or not. So now if you want to print it, it will give you false, right? Because that particular file is not existing and we are not also creating. So you can see here this coming as false because that is not available. Training one is not available, only training is available. So once the file is created, I will not create any more, right? I will definitely not create. I will just give the path so that I am getting the path of the file, and after that I am checking it. So now it will be giving you true. You can see it will giving you true. Is it clear?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Now say I want to delete the file, right? So I am not creating because it's already there, right? So definitely I should not create multiple times. That is the reason I am removing that particular line of code. After that I want to delete the file, so I will be using file reference. So it is already created, so I am not creating any more time. So file dot delete, delete method is there, right? Delete. Okay, you can see here, you can see delete on exist, there is another method is available, right? So if it is exist only, it will delete. In case it is not exist, it will not delete. Okay, so definitely this exists, so I will use delete. Then after that, again if you want to check whether the file is exist or not, right, so you can create another variable called boolean b2. Okay, so I will be creating another variable boolean b2, and then I want to print it out. So what line of code we are writing here? So already file is there, that is the reason I am not creating any more time, right? And after the file is already available in my D drive, so definitely if I want to check whether the file is exist or not, so it will give me true result, right? So here it will be giving me true. Okay, after that I am deleting the file, right? So after that, if I want to again check whether the file is exist or not, so it will give me false. Okay, and here file will be also deleted, that particular online training file will be deleted. So let's run the code here and see what is happening here. You can see first it is coming as true, right, because it was there initially. After that, it deleting, it is not there. And if you want to check from your deep drive, you can see that file is deleted here, right? So that's all about from the file standpoint. File means directory or folder, right? So we can create multiple files. Now say if you want to create one more file, say again one, right? So you have to create that, because it is otherwise it will not be existing. Okay, so now if you want to create it, so it will be creating, and after that immediately it will be removing it. Okay, so first it will be giving it true and false. So now you can see you are not able to see, because it created and again deleted. So that's why these are the operation can be performed for the file standpoint or directory standpoint. Now say I want to create some file means here, or not directory, but I want to create some text file or doc file, or maybe say Excel file, I want to create it, right? So I can do it. Okay, so suppose I want to create in that path some file, right? So similar way I will be here use that options, right? File equal to, and here I need to give the path here. So that path I am giving here. In that particular path I want to create a file. Okay, and then here you need to give some file name, right? Suppose Java file dot txt, you have to give it, right? Extension also you have to give it. That is the directory path and this is the file name. Okay, as it is a file, right, not directory, so you have to use that method, right? Create new file. So I will be using that method here, right? File dot create new file, you can see that method is getting appearing, right? So after that, if you want to check before navigating to the file create, so if you want to create a file, you have to either use some throws declaration or you have to surround with catch. So I will be using IO exception here, because this is the file, right? That is the reason some IO exception will need to, you have to handle it. Some path in case not visible or file is open, so you have to handle it. That is the internal Java, no need to worry. Now suppose say I want to check whether the file is exist or not, I will be creating another variable called b3 here, right? After that I want to check whether that particular file is exist, not the folder. Okay, so first it will be giving me the path, but here in that path nothing is available, but I will create a file with the help of that method, create new file. And after that, once it is created, I will check whether the file is exist or not, right? It is exist, so it will give me that particular boolean value. It will be definitely true, otherwise it will be false. Let's run it. So in the Selenium folder, you can see there is no test Java file is there, right? Only test or file. Maybe you can remove here. Okay. So on no file is there in the Selenium path, right? But if you run here, you can see. So it is giving you true, right? That means your file is exist now and it is already created from the code itself. If you don't want it to go to that particular path, okay. So if you now if you verify here, you can see that Java file is created, okay. If you open it, nothing will be there because you are not writing anything, right? You are just creating the file. So that's why you can create the file, right? Now, if you want to remove the file, right? So you need to use file dot, right? Delete on exist. You can use. I will be using that keyword. In case it exists, then only it will delete. After that, in case if you want to check whether again exists or not, so you have to check it. So it will be definitely false, right? 4. So it will be false. So I need to comment out this line of code because the file is already created, right? Or if you want to give the file name is different, so you can give it. So it will be created or it will be deleted. Now I want to objective is that I want to delete the file, whatever file is already there. So I am going to that particular path. After that, I am checking existing, so it will be definitely there. After that, I will be clicking. In case it is exist, I will be clicking, so it will be deleting it. Right? Let's do it and let's see. Okay, so delete on exist. It is not deleting, so I need to use. Okay, it's deleted, but here it's still giving me true. File exist, no, it should not be there. Okay, some problem here, but it should not be there. Okay, let's try to execute once more the code. Here it will you can, okay, it's now giving both false, it is not exist. Okay, that's why you can check it. Now there are more other properties is there for the file, right? So here let's comment it out, all this stuff. So you know how to create and delete a folder and file. So I'll be creating a new file again. So Java file 1. Okay. So you have to use definitely file create new file. So I'm giving the path here and after that I'm creating the file again. Right? After that, in case if you want to check whether the file is readable, writable, absolute path, you can check it, right? SOISO. I'll be using that of reference here. Dot. I will try to use the method, right? Can read, right? Then if I want to check whether it's can writables, right? I can use it, that method. Dot can write. Okay. Similar way, if I want to check the other things, I can check it. If I want to get the path of the file, right? So I have to use dot get absolute path. So you can, I mean, play some around with that particular methods, whatever available is there, right? You can get the absolute path, right? If you want to get the name of the file, you can get the name of the file. So file dot get name, you can see here, right? After that, if you want to get the file length, right? So now obviously file length will be zero because nothing is there in the file, right? So I can check the name length. If you want to check whether the file is hidden or not, right? So you can also do the check hidden, is hidden, right? So you need to check whether file is hidden because these are the already all the methods available in the file class, right? Is hidden. I need to close with second bracket. So now right now there is no such file is there, Java file 1.txt, right? Here nothing is available. So first it is getting the path with the help of file class. Then it is creating the new file. After that, I want to check whether it's readable, writable, and I want to get the absolute path, get the name, get the length, and whether the check is hidden or not. Let's try and let's see what is the output is there. So it can read, right? Definitely I can read it. In case any content is there, I can write it also. Right? I can get the absolute path. This is the path, right? Okay. So if you do not go to the location, so from the absolute path itself, if you write, go to that path, you can see here. Right, that direct file is getting open. Okay, so that is the absolute path. That is the file name, right? This is the extension txt, and now right now it is zero. There is nothing available in the file. It is hidden? No, it is not hidden. That is the reason it is visible, right? Now if you right click here and if you go to the properties, you definitely you can get the path, right? D drive selenium, and this is the file name, right? And this is the extension of the file, right? and you can see size is 0 bytes. Okay, here you can see read only and hidden is not checked. That means it is not read only, it is writable definitely, right? Hidden is not checked, read only also not checked attribute. If you go to the advanced, you can see file is ready for archiving. These are the different properties coming, but it is not read only or not hidden, right? Now suppose say I want to make the file as read only, right? I can do it. How can you do it? Okay, so suppose I want to change the file as read only. So here obviously file is created, so I am not creating the file any more time, right? But I want to check, I mean make the file as read only. Okay, so now say with the help of object reference I want to change the file as read only dot. You have to use the method. What is the method name? You have to use method set read only. Okay, set read only, so file will be readable only, so file will not be writable anymore now. Okay, now if you want to print whether this is still writable or not, you can print it once again. Okay, so I will be using that method here, file made read only, so that output will be displayed here. After that, if you want to check whether the file, are you able to write it or not, so you can see here it will be not write, it will give you false, right? It will give you false. Here it will give you true because it is definitely writable. So if you want to check once read also, so definitely read, I mean read only file also you can read it, right? So it will be same true only. So let's run the code and let's see. You can see here true in its first is true, second is also true, then you can get the absolute path here, then you can get the name of the file here, then you can get the length here, then you can get it whether hidden or not, right? Then we are making the file as read only, then we are checking, so file made read only, that output is coming. Then file can be read, yes definitely it can be read. Then it can be write, no it is not writable now, so because it will be false. So after it is setting to read only, so it cannot be written, I mean writable. So let's open the file here, so right click the file here, okay, go to the properties. You can see that read only checkbox has been checked, right? So it is read only, you are will not able to write anything. If you open the file and if you want to write anything and if you press save, you are not able to save it, but it will open you to save in different file name. So that's why you can validate whether the file is read only or not. Okay, but if you go to the properties here, but it will be definitely checked, right? Okay, now again if you want to set, right? So if you unchecked it, again try to run it once more and let's see what is happening here. Okay, so you can see now it is getting changed. Okay, again it will be read only. Okay, so there is let's check it. So every time you can change it to read only, so it will be read only. So that is the different operations we can perform for creating the file, validating all the details like that. Now I will show you how we can read and write the data in the file whatever we are creating here, right? So let's remove the file here. I'll be creating a new file here. Okay, suppose I am giving the file name as Selenium Java file, so that is the file I want to create it. So first let's create the file here. Okay, so file will be created here, no output will be there, but file will be created, right? You can see file and you can write here something, right? If you save here, you can save it. Let's remove everything, I don't want to write anything. So if you open the file, so nothing is there, right? But here I want to write something in the file, right? So how we can write it? Okay, so you have to use file writer or buffer writer or other stuff, right? For writing file writer, buffer writer or file output stream. So any one of the class you can use it, right? So here I'll be using with file writer, because it's very easy. File writer for writing any data in the file, and file reader for reading the data in the file. So suppose say here, after creating the file, I'm commenting out. So I'm just taking the path here, right? Then I'll be using file writer. Okay. So here I'll be using file writer. Okay. And I am creating a variable here, right? File writer FW equal to new file writer, and here I need to give that particular reference variable for the file class. Here you get some error messages coming, because you need to import right file writer from java.io package. Okay, after that you need to use another class, buffer writer, right, for storing the value in the buffer writer. So I'll be using buffer writer, buffered buffered writer. I'll be creating some variable called buffer writer bw equal to new buffer writer, and here you need to give the reference of file writer, right, variables. So in the bracket you need to give that reference. Now you can see some error message is still coming, right, because you need to import, right, buffer writer. Okay, now you can see nothing is there, right. Now if you want to write something, so you have to use that particular variables, right. Then dot write, you can see there is a method called come will write, right. So I want to write some string. Okay, so here in the string you can write something, right. Okay, suppose I want to write Selenium WebDriver with Java online training. That part I want to write in the text file. Okay, now you have to close everything, right, all the buffer reader and all the buffer writer, right, everything you need to close it. So first I'll be close, what is the way, and you need to go to the reverse way. So I'll be closing first the buffer writer dot close, and then I'll be closing file writer close. Otherwise it will throw some error, that is the reason we need to close it, maybe update cannot be successful. So whenever you will be using any kind of writer, right, okay, you have to close them, right, before, I mean, completing your code or leaving it, right, so that it will be successful. So I am getting the path here, right, so this is the path. So because that particular file I already created, nothing is there here. So okay, I am getting the path first with the help of file class, then I am creating a file writer class for writing it, right. So I am entering the reference here. So that particular text file I want to write it, then I am using buffer writer class, so it will be storing something in the buffer writer, right, and then I am writing that particular not here FW, so it will be BW. So otherwise nothing will be happen. Before I will write the buffer writer which is storing the value, so that's why again it will go to the file writer and the file update will be successful. So I am closing that buffer writer, right, and I am closing the file writer. Let's run it and let's see what is happening here. So definitely there will be no output, right, but here you can see if you open the file here, so that's part will be updated here, right, Selenium WebDriver with Java online trainings, because that is the path I want to update here in the when my code. So that is updated successfully. So that's why you can write anything, right. So let's create another file here, suppose file 1. Okay, and after that if you want to create another file here, then you try to create directly create file dot create new file. Okay, then closing it, and let's print something, training online training session, only that word I want to add it. Okay, and here if you want to print something in the console, you can still print it. added, right? So that's output I want to print it. Okay, so that there is no such file available, so it will create the file and after that it will add the data. Okay, let's run. Here no such file called extension one is there, right? File one is there, only file is there. So here it will create the new file, after that it will update the data in that file. So if you run it, output also will be there, right? Selenium WebDriver with Java online training sessions should be added here. And if you refresh the D drive, you can see that file is getting created. Selenium Java file, the one, right? And you can see here, it is updated, right? That is the part I have tried to update it in the till session. So it is updated successfully. Okay. So that is the for way for reading writing the data in the file. Let's comment it out the code and let's see how we can read the data from the file. Okay. Now in the file that is already available, Selenium WebDriver Java online training session, it's already available. Now I want to read the file, right? So how you can read the file? So I have to use file reader and buffer reader class available in Java, right? So here let's first, this is the path, right? I am giving first, this is the file I want to read it. So this path I am giving it. Okay, then you have to use some string for reading the file. So I want to read all the text. Okay, so I am giving the variable name as text. Then you have to use file reader class, and here you can create a variable called fr file reader. Fr equal to new class refer the name, and then again here you need to give the reference of the file, right, where the file is kept. Okay, then you need to import the file reader class from java.io package. After that, similar way you need to create buffer reader, right? Instead of buffer writer, here it will be file reader and here it will be buffer reader. So I'll be creating a class buffer reader instead of writer, because I want to read the file, right? Reader buffer br equal to new buffer reader, and here I need to pass the reference here. So I'll be passing the reference of file reader, right? Okay, now I need to import it, and I need to here give the reference of the file reader. Okay, so here I have given the file as fr, so I have to change here fr also. Okay, no, sorry, it is file, because two variable cannot be same. Okay, otherwise it will throw some error. Now you can see error message gone, right? Then I want to read the file. Before reading the file, I will check in case the file is having some value or not. In case it is null value, so there is nothing will be printed in the console, right? So I will only print out in case there is some value, right, in the file. So I will be using some while condition. While, suppose I want to give text, whatever variable we are declared, I want to keep in the text, right? While text equal to the buffer reader, you have to use that variable, so buffer reader, right, dot read line, you have to use that methods, right, read line, because I want to read all the lines one by one. In case it is not equal to null only, then it is not equal to null, means it is null, so there is nothing will be displayed, right? So in case I want to check whether it is not equal to null, okay, then only I want to print the value of the buffer reader, SOISO. I want to print the value of the text. Here some error message is coming, you can see. So I have to give a, so I had to close with here, okay, because this is the complete method, text equal to, that is the, I want to check it, not null, you can see it is, I want, then I want to print it, right? Then similar way, I have to close that buffer reader variable first, br dot close, and similar way I have to close the file reader, fr dot close. Okay, now let's run the code and let's see how it is behaving. Okay, you can see, right? Selenium WebDriver with Java online training session is coming from the file one, right? Because the file one, it was already there, right? Sorry, in the file one, it is already there. Okay. Now let's update it. I want to update. I want to give the date here, 12 December, and let's keep the file open here. Okay. Let's keep the file open and let's see. Are you able to write it? Sorry, I mean read the data or not? Okay. So I have kept the file open after saving it because it will able to read it. Right, because reading is not a problem whether file is open or not, but in case if you want to write something, right, so it will give you some error. So that is the difference. Okay, so here you already seen my last line of code, right? So you can see its updated part is also displayed. Okay, now you can close it. Okay, now I'm commenting out this line of code here. Okay, now removes everything. Okay, in the Selenium file one. Okay, okay. After that, let's keep it open. Okay, and let's try to add the data. So in the last line, we have created that particular part. Let's try to run it. So you want to update the data. Okay. Sorry, until. So it will be removed here. You run it. You can see what is the output is coming. It is coming here, right? But here nothing will be updated. That is, the file is open. Okay, let's see. Let's close it and let's open it again. Okay, sorry. One second. Let's check me the code here. So what is the reference I have given? Okay, file equal to new reference I have given here. Okay. Still it is getting updated. Okay. Okay, because I have used IO exceptions, right? Otherwise it should throw some error. Okay. Let's remove it once more time and let's keep it open and let's see how it is behaving. This is the path here, Selenium 1. So it will still update it. And this is the part I want to update it. Let's run the code once more. Let's see. Okay, that part is coming here. And if I, okay, right now you can see here, nothing is there, the file is open, right? So that is the difference. You need to close it. And again, after that, if you open it, you can see the updated data, right? Okay, so that's why you can read and write any file available in the, I mean, you can create any directory, you can create any file, you can update the data, and you can read the data. Okay, so that's all about from the file handling. There are a lot of things is there, but still you can learn it. But this is the basic stuff. If you know this basic, it will be help you to other. I mean, go through the other part easily. So any questions here? Before moving to the other part, other topics. Ankur, Jivita. Hello, Ankur, are you able to hear me?
Hello.
Yes, any questions?
No.
Okay, fine, cool. Okay, and then I'll go for the next topic here. Let's close the file. So, immutable string in Java. Okay. Because you know, right, I mean, whenever you are dealing with string, right, so string by nature is immutable, means you will not able to update the string, normal string, right? So there are other way through which you can update the string, but normally strings cannot be updated. Okay, So in Java, string objects are immutables. Immutable simply means unmodifiable or unchangeable. Once string object is created, its data or state cannot be changed, but a new string object can be created from that. Because immutable object cannot be changed, they can be shared among multiple threads freely. Because this is not changed, right? So we can change it multiple threads. So because the same value will be there for every, suppose the particular string is accessed in 10 times, so it will not impact because the same value will be only there everywhere. So this eliminates the requirement of doing synchronization. Whenever I want to synchronize means I want to real-time update all in all the area. So the immutable nature of the string will be helpful because, from the other area, synchronization means so I am accessing a particular object 10 times. But in one place, if it is updated, so definitely other object will be affected, right? But as the nature of the string is immutable, it cannot be modifiable or changeable. So there is no such, risk is there, right? So that any particular thread will be updating that or not. So that is the main nature of the string. Okay. And that is the reason we can use it in multiple threads freely. Java uses the concept of string literal. Suppose there are 10 reference variables. All refer to one object Java. Each reference variable changes the value of the object, it will be affected to all the reference variables. That is why strings objects are immutable in Java. I already mentioned in the previous example, right? Now I will show you how, right, we can verify the nature of the string is immutable. Okay. So let's create a variable here for string. So str. You can also change the declaration now. There is no need to edit it. So I'll be declaring a string variable string str equal to or s1 equal to selenium java. Okay, that's the thing I want to see. Declare it, but you can see only that particular string cannot be modifiable, right? So if I want to concat something, right? So how can you? I can concat it. Concat means addition, right? String addition. Suppose I want to concat something. So suppose so I'll be using so that I can print it out in the output, right? After concatenation. So I'll be using so that variables s1, right? Dot concat methods available in the string. Here s1 dot concat. Okay. And here I can give the other string, whatever I want to concat. Selenium Java, I want to concat with training. So I am giving some space here. After that, I want to add it. Right. So now if you run here, you can see it will be printed out Selenium Java and training. Okay. Now, if you print out only S1, you can still print it out, SO, ISO. I will be only printing out the S1. And after concatenation, it will be Selenium Java training. Because you can't modify anything, right, for the string. A string is immutable. Okay. Now, you can get the substring, right? You can get it. And you can, use the substring as and when required, right? So suppose I want to get the substring of that S1, right? And I want to store it in another string, okay? Suppose say I want to store it with another string, suppose say S2. And I want to get with the help of substring, right? So how can I get the substring? So I have to use the reference of the string initially. Then dot get substring, you can see here, right? So that's how you can get it, right? You can only give the index here. Only bigger index, so the remaining part will be there. And if you give the beginning index and end index, so you can give only the middle part, right? So I'll be giving the beginning index. Suppose I am giving 3 and suppose I am giving 7. So that is the index I want to give it. And that string I want to store it in the S2 variable, right? So that then I want to print it out, right? S2. Okay. Now, what will be the output? You can see here output is right ENIU. So 3 means it is starting with that. It is 0, 1, 2, right? Because starting with 0. So this is 3, right? 3, 4, 5 and 6. So it will go till, start with 3 and it will go till 6. That is the part I already, I think, discussed in the last session, whenever I was completing the session for different methods available in the string, right? So that's why we can validate, right? We can get the substring of a particular thing. Suppose if you give simply here 3 here, right? So it will give you all the word from that word, that part. So let's give it. So I am giving only the beginning index. You can see here that part is coming, right? Starting from 3. Now after getting the s2, storing its different variable s2, if you want to concatenate it, right, with that part, suppose I want to concatenate that substring dot concat, okay, suppose training, I want to concatenate with the word online. Okay, let's run it and let's see what is happening here. So first it will give you the substring will be that, right? Then you can see it is getting concatenated. Online is getting added, simply added, because I here did not give any space. If you want to give any space, you have to give the space here. So right now it will be, some space will be there. You can see here some spaces is there. So that's what is coming. Substring is getting converted here. After that, the substring, I want to concatenate, right, that part. So it is getting concatenated. So that is the different thing of right, string, immutable nature of the string, because it cannot be modifiable. Only string cannot be modifiable. Then some drawback will come, right? Then why are we using the string, right, in case it is not modifiable at all? So this is the basic feature of the string. But string can be modifiable with some other important attributes available in Java, okay? But if you want to simply use the string, so you will be using only string without any other characteristic. So that is the reason it can be shared with multiple threads freely, so that none of the threads can be updated, right? So obviously it will not getting change your parent value, right? So we have to use string buffer class available in Java if we want to provide some operation on the string, right? So string buffer is a peer class of string that provides much of the functionality of string. String represent the fixed length immutable character sequence, while string buffer represent growable and writable character sequence, right? It can be grow, or it can be, we can write something, we can update something, we can delete the string with the help of string buffer, right? Okay, so that is the class. String buffer may have characters and substring inserted in the middle or appended to the end. It automatically grow to make room for such additions and opens as more characters be allocated than are actually needed to allow room for growth. So you can update it based on a requirement. String buffer are safe for use by multiple threads. The methods can be synchronized wherever is necessary, so that all the operations to any particular instance behave as they occurred in some serial order. Okay. String buffer also, it can be useful for multiple threads as well. Okay. The method can be synchronized wherever necessary. Okay, as and when it's necessary, so methods will be only, the particular methods will be updating, so that all the operation on any particular instance behave as they occur in some serial order, so that it will be behave just like it have happened on serial order, right? So that that will update the other thread. So that's why actually happened. Whenever an operation occurs involving a source sequence, right, suppose we want to add something, we want to insert something in the middle of the string, this class synchronize only on the string buffer performing the operation, not on the source, right? But source part will not be updated, okay? It will update the only the remaining part. So that is the beauty of the string buffer class, okay? Your original string will be not be updated, but you can get something, so that original string meet, it will definitely give you the result. Got it? Okay, suppose already a string is there, suppose A, B, C, D, okay, if I want to update the value, not on the original string, but I want to use somewhere, so that where I will update, so that I can perform some operation, so that particular features will be updated in my thread, but it will not impact the original string will still A, B, C only, because things are immutable, but with the help of string buffer class I can update based on my requirement, so that only part will be updated and it will reflect my requirement, but it will not impact my original particular properties of the string. Okay, so whenever I will be giving some example, you will be able to completely get it. So let's declare some string, just like the string I have created here. Let's declare this string only. So I will be creating a string str. Okay, then we have to use this particular buffer class, right? String buffer class, string buffer. Suppose I am giving a string buffer sb variable name equal to new string buffer. Here you need to provide the reference of the string, right? Okay, now go to the next slide. Here what are the different methods available in the string buffer, right? These are the important method. Okay, first one is append. If you want to add some text at the end of the string, insert if you want to insert something middle of the string, if you want to replace something, if you want to delete the particular instant particular part, right, from the using the string buffer class, you can do it. You can reverse the string. You can get the length and capacity of the string. Okay, so length is total number of variable, capacity is, right, you can get the capacity means how many variables you can store in the string, right? So capacity will be added with the length plus plus 16 digit, because 16 digit is the, right, whenever you are dealing with the capacity. So capacity refers to the total amount of the character storage size in the string buffer. An empty string buffer class contains the default 16 character capacity. So in case suppose say length is 10, so capacity will be 10 plus 16 equal to 26. So here I will be showing you how string buffer class can be used, right? So you need to import the string buffer class here. After that, if you want to append something, right, so you can do it easily. Suppose I want to append something, so I will be using that particular variable here, sb dot append. Okay, suppose I want to append some string selenium java, and that part I want to append training. Okay, you can see here it will be appended. Okay, after that, if you simply use here, no need to create an need to store it another variable, so it will be simply appended. So SOISO, if you want to use it, print it now. Let's print it and let's see what is happening here. So you can see Selenium Java training. Now if you want to print your original string, right? Okay, I want to print my original string. So what will happen? Your original string will not be affected anymore, but you are creating an object or instance with the help of string buffer class, where you need to perform some operations so that, right, it will impacted your test case accordingly or impacted your requirement. You can see here your original string is still Selenium Java, because strings are immutable in nature, right? So strings cannot be updated. That's the basic principle, you have to remember it, right? But if you want to do some, create some instances where something will be updatable, you have to create the string buffer class and you have to create an object instance that can be updated anything. So that's the beauty of that particular string buffer class. Okay, now say in the string buffer class I want to amend something, right? So let's comment it out here, I mean in the middle, right? So here you will be using sb dot instead of append, so I want to insert something in the middle, insert, insert. So I will be giving the offset here, index offset, anything. So suppose I am giving some offset here, I can give the offset, right? Suppose I want to insert, what is the position? Suppose I want to give position as 5, and then here I can, yes.
Sorry, my internet
got disconnected. So which part still you have covered it?
String str and you wrote Selenium Java and then
yeah. Okay. So here I am saying that as string is immutable in nature, right? You can't perform any operations on the string itself, but with the help of string buffer class, you can create a object or instance or variable which can be you can modify it. Okay, so here suppose string, I declared a Selenium Java, and I want to append something in the middle, right? Okay, so I'll be using string buffer class where that variable I want to append something. So I am in the fifth position, I want to append it. And whatever I want to append it, suppose say training, I want to append it. Okay. Now you need to close with semicolon, and then you simply need to print out, right? You no need to store any other string. So that is the beauty of the string buffer class. But your original string will not be changed. Okay. Suppose if you want to change, check, and also if you want to print your original string. Let's see the difference. Okay, so here this is the original string. So this should not be updated in any circumstances. Okay, but if I want to perform some operation on the string as well, so I need to use the string buffer class where I will be creating a variables. So that variables I can update it with that particular class itself, right? With that variable I can insert something, I can amend something, right? Append something with the help of append methods. So now if you run your program, you can see here. Your string will be still not updated, right? Your string will be Selenium and Java only. But here, I have created.
But your method is sb.insert, that it is getting inserted.
Yeah, here you are printing sb, right? Sb is this, and str is this, right? These are the two things we are printing out. Str is still this. You can see Selenium, Java only. SB, right? So actually if string is originally this, so you are getting SB with that original string. Now with the fifth place, it will be appended, right? So it is 0, it is 1, it is 2, 3, 4, and this is till 4, right? So with the fifth place, it will be appended. So after selen, you can see training is getting appended, right? After that IUM, it's coming. After that Java. But your original string is not getting changed, right? Now say other operation, right? If I want to replace the string, okay, suppose here I will be using, instead of sb dot thing, I will be using as sb dot replace. Okay, so here you can give some position, right? So suppose I want to replace as positions with any word, you can give it, right? I can replace as 2, and here I can give as 5. This is the position I want to replace it, and I want to replace with some string. Okay, so I can give some string with, suppose say, test. Okay, so that part will be replaced with the test keyword, right? Here 2, right? That part will be replaced here, sorry, from that one. So that will not be there, it will be replaced by test. Let's run it and let's see how it is behaving. You can see here SE is there, right? After the remaining path is replaced with test, right? And IUEM is there. Okay, so 2 to 5 is getting replaced. So that's what LEN is getting replaced with T. Okay, so Selenium SE test IEM Java, and here string is not getting updated. Similar way, if you want to reverse it, right? So SB dot reverse. Okay, so it will be reversing the string. So let's change it, run it. You can see it's reversing, right? From this side Selenium and Java, but original string is not getting impacted. Now say if you want to get delete of the few part, right? So you can delete it, simply delete. It is not replace, it's delete, right? Replace is different. Okay, here you can give, right? If you give only index, so remaining part will be deleted, right? Or you can give starting and middle, you can still give it. Suppose I want to delete remaining part, suppose after 8, okay, and into close with semicolon. Okay, let's run it. So only the till the 8th 7 percent will be there, right? and it will be sorry delete character at only 8 character is getting deleted, right? Whatever is there in the 8th character, 0 1 2 3 4 5 6 7, in 8 is space is there, right? So space is getting deleted. Selenium Java, if you want to delete 7th position, so it will be, aim will be deleted, right? You can see here aim will be deleted, right? And if you want to give delete more one, suppose 7 to 10 I want to delete. Okay, so it will be delete, not character add. Okay, I want to delete from that position to that position. So you can see here, right? Selenium, that particular part is getting deleted, 7 to 10. This part is getting deleted, 7 to 10. And it is remaining part is there. Okay, now say if you want to get the length of the string, okay. So you can get it, right? Length of the string. So how can you get it? Simply you have to give the, right, that particular variable dot length. Okay. Now see, if you want to get the capacity of the string, also you can get it. String dot capacity. Not the string, through string that variables. Right, whatever you have created with the help of string buffer class from that particular string, because that string will not be updated. So what is the capacity? You can see here. So length is 13, right? This is 13 character, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11 12 13. So obviously index will start from 0, it will go till 12, right? So and total length is 13. And how the capacity is calculated? So I already mentioned, right, capacity refers to total amount of character storage size in string buffer. An empty string buffer class contains the default 16 character capacity. So here it is, as it is coming as 13, right? And capacity will be here. What will be the capacity here? So it will be 13 plus 16, right? So it should be 29. You can see it's coming as 29. So that is the different method or operation is available in the string buffer class. Okay, so this is the immutable nature of the strings. So in case we are want to create some object or instance of the string, but without impacting the original string, we can do it. So that is the reason it will be also be used in the multi-threaded, right? Because it will only create the instance from the string, and that can be used anywhere. We can use that reference, right? So is it clear? Or any questions? Okay, good. So the next is like, what is the importance of this keyword, right? So this keyword is a reference variable in Java that refers to the current object. Okay, this can be used for any kind of, it can be for methods, it can be for variables, it can be for constructor, it can be used, right? So this, in case if you want to create for, instance, right? So this can be used to refer current class instance variable. Similarly, this can be used to invoke current class method. Similarly, this can be used to invoke current class constructor. The this keyword can be used to refer current class instance variable as well. If there is ambiguity between the instance variable and parameter, the keywords resolve the problem of ambiguity. Okay. So let's try to create a method here. The main method in the, you know, right? So how, if you want to create some method, it will be in the class level, not at the main method level. Suppose I want to create some method, right? So public void, and you need to give the method, right? Test method. And this is the body I need to give it, right? I can give anything. Okay. Suppose say test. Here you need to give it, suppose test method. Okay. Now suppose if you want to use it in the main class, you have to create object or instance, right? So object equal to new, then the object again. Now if we want to print it out, right, so you have to use that object dot, you can see the method will be coming here, right? Test method. Now if you print here, the method body will be printed out. You can see the test method is coming here, right? Okay. Now say I will be creating another method. Okay, suppose test method 1. Here you can update it test method 1. But in the test method, I want to also call the test method, right? So how can you call it? So you have to use this keyword dot method name. That method you can see here, right? So that output will be coming again. That method will be called inside that method, right? Now if you want to call the test method 1, right? So let's run it. Let's see. So that is the importance of this keyword. You can see output is coming too, because that is the output is coming, and in that method I am calling that method again, right? So with that help of this keyword, I'll be running actually two methods.
Sorry,
okay. Yeah. So I am first creating a method here, right? This is the method. Forget about the other method. Okay. This is the method is creating, and if you want to call that method in the main class, so I am creating an object, and with the help of object, if you run it, so it will be executed, and definitely you will get the method, right? Body, test method, right? After that, I want to create another method, right? Where I also use that method here. Suppose say there is an example of suppose a rectangle, right? Or a particular suppose say any area circle is there, right? Okay, suppose you can guess the total area, right, with the help of pi r square, and if you get the radius, I mean different thing, you can use 2 pi r, so you can get the total area this side, rounding shape, right? And if you get the total area, you have to use the 2 pi r square, that is circle. So you are creating a method for suppose getting the 2 pi r, but you also want to get the pi r square, right? So you will be creating another method, and for the 2 pi r you will be calling that method here. So both the method will be created, I mean used in a single method. So that's what I want to write it here. Okay, so this method I will write it here, but I am creating another method where this is my output, as well as I want to call that method, right? I want to call that method as well. So I will be using this keyword here, and I will be using test method. That means method name. Now instead of test method one, test method, if I want to run test method 1, definitely that part will be executed, and definitely that method will be called, and hence that part will be also executed. Suppose let's change it to 1. You can see both the output is coming, right? First that part based on the order. If you want to change the order, so it will be also order will be changed. You can see the order is getting changed here, right? That part is getting executed and that part is getting executed later. Is it clear now?
Yes.
Okay. So let's comment out this thing. Let's paste it in other portions. Let's remove comment it out also. Okay. Now here in the class level, I want to create some constructor. You know the how to create the constructor, right? So constructor name will be same name as the class name, and there will be no method type, and there will be no access modifier, right? So I'll be creating a constructor, that is the constructor, right? And there will be some body, that is the syntax of the constructor, right? And here I'll be creating some variable. Okay. Suppose say there is a student, right? So for each and every student, right, there will be some name, roll number, right, and some address will be there. Suppose suppose I want to get the first state only for the student, right? So student can belong to a different state, right? If it is only from the India only, West Bengal, Delhi, right, or maybe Delhi or maybe Maharashtra, like that. Okay. So suppose I am declaring some variable for student, sorry, first integer roll number. Okay, that is the variable I am calling here. suppose integer name. So I'm just declaring the variable. Okay, then string, sorry, integer not name, integer roll number, string will be name, integer roll number. Okay, string name, and similar way string can be state, right, or can be country as well. Okay, so these are the four variable is there, right? One is integer roll number, one is different name, state and country which belongs to, right? Then I am creating a constructor where I am want to get roll number, name and suppose say country only instead of four. Okay, so I'll be using integer, I'm passing three parameter, integer then roll number. If you select is same, right, roll number then string, if you want to pass it same variables. And then another one, suppose a country, say. Then you have to assign some value, right? Okay. Suppose say roll number equal to roll number. Then name equal to name. And then country equal to country. In that particular constructor I am writing, then I am creating a variables method, public void suppose display, this is the method.
What is the need of declaring it into the same variable, roll number that is equal to roll?
No, that is the reason I am telling you. Okay, let's wait for some time. So after that I will give you the complete pictures. Okay, because in real time sometime we will not change it, right? We keep them at same because I want to map that variable to that variables. Okay, got it? That is the reason. So this is the different, whenever you are passing something, right, you can change it to anything, right? You can change it to roll number 1 also. Okay, so I want to map roll number 1 to roll number, but actually generally during the framework creation that should be the same. Okay, we did not change it so that like easily you can identify it, right? Otherwise if you change it to roll 1, roll number 1, it will be contradiction will happen, right, and it will be problem. Suppose now I want to refer this thing with that particular variable we have declared, right? So I have tried to assign it with the same thing, but it is not like that. This I want to map with that one. Okay, so I want to display something, so I'll be using SYSO method. I want to display roll number. I want to display roll number and I want to concatenate, right, roll number, then I am giving some space here, and again I want to concatenate name in same method here, and then again giving the plus operator and I am giving some space here again, then I want to display, right, state. Okay, and then again plus operator, again some space, again plus operator, and also I want to display country in the same variables, same method, right? Here are some messages coming. Okay, what is the problem? So here I need to pass the reference variable, right? Okay, I can need to pass it. Suppose I will be passing all this stuff here as well. And also I need to pass one thing, right? I need to pass state as well, because here I have written code for three different variables, right? Not for four. So I'll show you how we can implement it with this keyword. So string state. Okay, now you can see error message gone, still there, roll number, name, state. country, what is the error message? Syntax token, I need to keep it. Plus state, plus country, everything is there. Okay, let's check it. Okay, open SDL should be no public here because it is creating in that particular part. So void display, this is the method name here, and I want to give everything in the particular thing, right? System out, roll number here, then name. Okay, here I need to give some plus, right? That is the reason. Okay, got it. So that is the method I am creating, where I am passing the same reference here. Now as the constructor is there, right? So I will be creating an object or instance for the constructor. So similar way, I will be creating an object or instance. Okay, then with the help of object, and you can see some error message is coming, right? Because as it is a constructor, you have to give it the reference number, right? Okay, so roll number, suppose I am giving 1, then I am giving name as suppose say John, and then I am giving suppose say country. Okay, suppose say I am giving country India only, IND. Okay, then you can see error message gone. Now if you want to use that method, right, object dot, what is the method name? Display name. Object dot display. This is the constructor I have created here. Public void, it is not working. Add argument to match display. One second. Void display. I want to print out everything, right? So I'll be using that reference here. I have given the reference everything, so I want to use it. Object dot display. Why it is coming again? Let me check once more from the scratch level. So I am defining some variable here. Okay, these are the different variables there. So at the class level, right, at the class level, these are the different variable. I am creating a constructor here, right? Season 8, this is the different part I am referring here. So I am passing it. Okay, then I am creating a variable for displaying. So simply void display, this is the method name, and here, okay, I am not passing anything, I don't need to pass anything. Okay, that is the reason it's error message is coming. So that is the reason if you calling it again, this is coming, right? I want to simply print out the value, so I don't want to pass anything. So I'll be simply calling the value, display method dot display. Okay, now it will be clear. Now let's run it. Then what will be the output? Output, everything will be default value, right? Whatever we have declared, nothing will be coming here. You can see here, this is the default value is coming, right? Though it is 3 values entered, but in the method I want to print 4 value, right? Roll number, type is integer, so default value is coming as 0, and for the other it is string, right? So default value is coming. For name is null, state is null, country is null. Why it is coming, right? So I am explaining it here. So these are the different variable we have declared here, right? Okay, these are the different variable I have declared here, and these are the variable I am passing it, right? Okay, but in case both are same, right? So with this reference, I am not able to call it. So that is the problem. It should not be called actually. So to avoid this thing, there is two way. You need to change the name here, right? Variable whatever is passing, you can change it, right? So now you can, if you assign it roll number 1 equal to roll number that variables, you are tagging it, right? Now you are trying to match it with here. So name 1 equal to 1 and country 1 equal to 1. Now let's run the code and let's see. In case both the variable are same, if you directly try to assign it, so that will not work, and it will give you the default value of the variables type based on the variable type, right? For integer, default value is 0. For string, default value is null. For float, default value is 0.0. For double, default value is 0.00, like that. Okay, it is still coming. So it should be roll equal to roll number 1, name equal to name 1, country equal to country 1. Let's run it once more, whether it's displaying or not. Okay, you can see now it is coming, right? So that variable should match with that variable. Okay, then if it is different name, then it will be coming, right? You can see the roll number is 1. I have entered here. So it will be, it is not easy. This code is not easy. It will take some time to understand. Again, I am repeating it. So this keyword, right? So it is coming as roll number. So I have entered 1, right? Then the name, I have entered John, right? In the through name 1. So John is coming. Then state, here is no such variable was created for the state, right? In the constructor. So state is coming as default value, because no value we are passing for state. Country, it is India. So India is coming. Now suppose say I want to keep the variable name as same only. Okay, then how can you solve the problem? Because in real time the variable value also will be same. You will not change it, so that it will not create contradictions to the developers who is developing the automation framework. So how can you implement it? So you have to use this dot roll number, this keyword dot, okay, this operator. So this dot roll number is matching with that. You can see here it's coming, right? This dot roll number is matching with that. And here, if you select here, it will be select that only. So similarly, if you use this dot name and this dot country here, dot country. Okay. Now, if you run your code again, see output will be correctly coming. So that is the beauty of this. Because in real time, you need to use constructor and you need to use this keyword. Wherever you will be using some class, right? Wherever you are passing some driver difference, web driver, driver, you have to use this dot driver equal to driver. Okay, now you can see we have 4 different variable, but for one variable we did not create any method, right, or constructor for state. So that is the reason it's coming as null. Okay, now let's create another constructor for the same. So here you can pass the state. Yes,
actually it didn't got cleared anyway.
Okay,
entire concept.
Yeah, it is not easy. That is the reason I am telling you. Okay, so I have declared 4 variables. Okay, so roll number, name, state and country, these are the variables. Okay, and here I have created a constructor, because constructor name will be same name as session 8, where I am passing some roll number variable, right? Because that will be I have entered during calling the constructor. Now if I want to match that variable with that variable, okay, that variable with that variable, that variable with that variable. So for state I did not create anything. So I have to use this keyword. In case variable name is different, then we can assign that variable to that declared wherever we are declaring it. But in case variable name is same, so this dot roll number is referring to that, and here roll number is referring to that. So that's why it will actually assign the value. Okay, whenever you are because you can't directly use it, right? You have to assign something somewhere to declare somewhere, right? And here you are passing the variables, but that variable will not work in case you are not defining the data type before that, right? First you have to give the data type, then you have to create any method with any kind of data type. Now if I want to give the same reference name, right, for the variable declared as well as the variables capturing in the method, right? So I have to use that this keyword. So I already showed you, in case we are not using this keyword, and here this is the method name. Simply I want to print all the variables value. This is the method name, and this is the constructor I am creating, where I am referring that particular stuff with that word. So I am using this keyword, and now in the main method I am creating an object or instance, right? And definitely, for whenever I am creating object or instance, right, as this is the constructor created, in case there is no constructor, so that is the reason by default constructor will be the class name, right? And you no need to pass anything. But as I have created the constructor, so I have to pass the reference value, relevant value, right, for these three variable, roll number, name and country. So I am passing it three variables. Okay, now with that particular reference of the object I have created, I want to call that methods, right? So in the method I am printing four different things in the whatever I have declared here, right, as part of my data type. I have declared these four variables, but you can see roll number, name, state and country. So this will be definitely based on the declaration. It will be trying to print out, right? First that based on the declaration, after that it will try to check whether value is available here, right, and based on the declaration here. So value will be based on the declaration, but here this value will be based on the declaration in the class level, variable declaration. This is called variable declaration, and this is called constructor declaration. So methods body will be coming from the variable declaration, right, and constructor body will be coming from the constructor declaration. Okay, now I am, as I have already added the value for, right, roll number, name and country only, and I did not added any value for state, right? So as and when you want to call that method, right, so only the right roll number, name and country is coming, but for state there is no value, so it will be coming as default value, null. So in case you are not using this keyword, right, so this roll number will be referring to that roll number only. Similarly, name equal to name and country equal to country. And here, as there is no such variable declaration is there, right, so it will be coming as default value, not that particular value you are entering in the constructor. So first you need to declare the variable type, right, and then from the variable type your method will be called based on that variable type. Okay, your method will be called based on the variable type you are declaring here, and here based on the constructor you are giving the value only, the value. Now this value is getting matched with this variable, right, and that is the reason it is printing here. Now in case that particular value whatever you are entering is not matching here, so it will be taking the default value, right? So that is the reason before using the this keyword it was coming as default value. Now it is clear or not?
Yeah, it's clear.
Okay, so now here you can see here four variable was there, right, but in the constructor I have created three variable only. Okay, so other variables I can create another method, right, constructor. So you can know, right, constructor and method can be overloaded. How you can overload it? With number of argument or number of changing the variables type, right? But here we already declared the variables, right? Okay, so I will be changing the variable type for the constructor, another variable here. So I will be adding another variable. Suppose here I want to add another variable called string name, right? So name is there, here is state. I want to declare another variable called state. So string data type will be string equal to state. Okay, now here I want to directly call the constructor, because in the first constructor I already written three variable, so I'll be not writing anymore, right? So I'll be writing only for state, right? So here I'll be giving this dot state equal to state. Okay, and after that I'll be directly calling the constructor. So how can I call the constructor? So I'll be calling the constructor here directly that constructor. Okay, so I'll be calling that constructor is this. If you press this, and dot you can get the constructor here. You can see here all the variable is coming, but if you call the constructor here, so simply you need to give the not date, so dot it will be this and then bracket, right? You need to give the constructor details. So here I will be giving the constructor detail as roll number first, then name, and no need to give the data type, and then country. I'm closing it. Okay, it's still not taking. What is the problem? So yeah, so I have to give the state as the last, because it is giving in sequence, right? So that is the reason it will not be allowing. Okay, you can see it's gone, right? So I am clearing once more time. So here I have declared four variables: roll number, name, state, and country, right? So I have created a constructor where I am using three variables only: roll number, name, and country, but state is not used, right? But I want to use all the variables declared, right? So that is the reason I have created a method, right, called display, where I want to get my roll number, name, and state, and country. So I need to create one more constructor, so that four variable I will be passing in. But I don't want to write everything again, all this line of code here, because I already had a constructor for this roll number, name, and country. So for this constructor, I will be using that using this keyword. I am giving the reference. So definitely roll number, name, and country will be called. And for state, whatever is not available, I am using state equal to state. Okay. So you have to give state at the last, because this will be should be in sequence, right? Roll number, name, and country should be in sequence. Otherwise, it will throw some error. And state will be coming at last or first. It can be in first as well. Now, if you give the call the constructor here, right? If you can give another thing, or maybe create another object here. So I'll be creating another object, obj1, right? Okay. Here I'll be calling the other constructor, so that for this constructor, these are the four different value is there, right? Roll number, name, country, and state, right? So suppose I need to give another value called state. State equal to I want to give West Bengal WB. Now can you can see error message gone. Now with that particular object or instance, if you want to call that particular variable methods, right, display, let's see what is the value is coming now. So here for the first object, right, only three variables I am defining. So that is the reason by default, right, here state is coming as null. But for the fourth one, I have given everything. So here it will be coming first roll number, then name, and then your state. So state will be West Bengal, then last country. But whatever sequence you are giving doesn't matter. So it will be getting based on the method sequence, right? Whatever you have given in the method. So let's run it and let's see. So for the first one, you can see one John, and state is as there is nothing is there, right? So it is coming as null and India. Now for the another constructor I am calling, right? So here object one and display method. So roll number is matching with one, and name is again John, and state is coming based on the given thing, because this whenever constructor definition you have given in the last part, right? But in the method it is coming in the third part. So obviously wherever you are giving doesn't matter, it will be again check with methods body. So it is coming as West Bengal, then country. So its country is matching. So is it clear now, or any confusion? But this is the very important key attribute, right? This keyword will be used multiple times in your during real time framework. Ankur, is it clear now? Okay, great. Okay, so I am commenting out everything here. Also commenting out everything. So the last topic for today's session is the importance of finally block. So in the last session, I think already shown, right, how to handle any any error message in case is coming, right? We can handle it with the try catch block. But similarly, with the try catch block, also you can include the finally block, right? So finally block contains all the crucial statement that must be executed whether exception occurs or not. So in the last session, I already shown the example, right? In case, suppose I am handling some exception, but in case the exception is not there, so your try catch block will be not be executed, right? But in case if you want to execute some statement, so you have to use finally block. So finally block will be executed in case of exception is appearing or not. It does not matter. It will be coming all the time. Okay? So finally block must be associated with the try catch block. You cannot use finally block without a try block. You should place those statements in this block that must be executed always. So finally block will be executed always. In case exception occur or does not occur, does not matter. In normal case, when there is no exception in try block, then the finally block will be executed after the try block. However, whenever there is an exception occur, right, then the catch block will be executed before the finally block. So this is the syntax, try, catch, finally. So first it will try to evaluate the statement. In case any exception, it will be caught by catch, right, and after that finally. In case there is no catch, so catch will be ignored, but still finally will be executed, right. Try block can be used with finally before catch also, okay. So I am first getting a simple example here. Okay, suppose I am defining some array. Okay, suppose integer, suppose a equal to array, right? And I want to define some variables here, right? Suppose if I do not define the value equal to sign, I am giving integer a because of very data type I am defining as integer, so it will be so all the variables will be integer 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 7, 8 like that, right? So these are the different value available, right? So size is 7, right? So it is starting with 0, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 like that, right? Now if you want to print out SOISO, right? So you have to give the A and then bracket, and then here you give the index, right? You have to give the index. Suppose if you want to give the 6th index, so it will be 7th variable. So it is starting with 0th index, 0. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So total length will be, right, 8, right, 0 to 7. So it will be 8. Now if you want to simply run it, you can get the element here for that array, right? It will give you 7. So this is the 6th index, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and total element is 8, right? Now suppose in case if you want to print something which is not element is available at all for the array. Suppose I want to print the 10th element, but element is total size is 8. That means total index will be available here 7, right? But if I want to get something called 10, so you can see some it will give you some exceptions, right? In my last session I already covered it, right? You can see exception in the main thread, right? So exception is coming. What is the exception name? Array index out of bound exception. So with the help of try catch block, right, we can handle the exception. So how you can add the try catch block? So that is the syntax here I have written here, right, try catch block. But still if you do not know, so you can also add it after right clicking here, right, surrounds with try catch block, right. Here if you know the exact exception, so you can give the exception name, otherwise you can still give the exception. Only generic exception. So in my last session I already covered it, so I know that this is the exception is coming, so I can handle it with that exception. So I am replacing it, right, that exception name, okay. Now, right, if you want to print out, right, the exception that will be printed. Now let's run it. You can see instead of etc press, I want to print out it, right? So let's remove it. SOISO, I want to print out it. So I will be printing out it. So what is the importance of exceptions? In case you are not handling any with the exceptions, right? So what the problem will be there? Next line of code will not be executed. But in case you are handling the exception, your next line of code will be executed. So in the last session, I already covered it. Okay, if you do not refer my video. So try to, if you do not watch it, so try to refer my last video. So here suppose I am giving it exception handle before using try catch block. Okay, right. So if you run it, you can see the next line of code will be also executed, right? Because we already handled the exception. Now let's comment it out it once more time. Control C. Comment it out. Source comment it out. Now I am not handling the exception. Okay. Suppose I am not handling the exception. I just simply, right, given the reference for the array, and I want to print something which is not, right, index of bound is find, right, and after that I want to execute that line of code. But in case exception is occurred, your execution will be abrupt at the step, right? Your execution will not be happened after that. So you can see here, you can see exception is coming, right, and the next remaining line of code is not being executed, right? But as and when we'll be handling with the try catch block, right? So let's comment it out or remove this part and let's uncomment it. So here I am handling the exception. I know that this is the exception is coming, array index out of bound exception is coming. So I will be handling it with that particular exception name, and I am printing out the error message. But after that, as I am handling the exception, so next line of code will be executed definitely. And you can get the exceptions, right? This is the exception is coming. Okay, this is the exception is coming, and next line of code is executed. So this is the concept of try catch block, right? But and now I am want to print something for the fifth element, fifth index, that means sixth element, right? So right now there is should not be any exception. So exception will not be triggered, right? Okay, and definitely next line of code will be exception. Though I have tried to cover it with try catch block, but there is no exception at all there. So your catch block will be completely ignored, right? You can still there, it can be, but your catch block will be completely ignored, and you will not print out any exception, right? You can see the it is coming as 6 because the fifth position is 6 only, and after that next line of code is executed, right? But in case you are using finally keyword, so finally can keyword can be associated with your try catch block, right? And you can get the result of finally block always. Okay, so it does not matter whether exception is big triggered or not, but finally block will be always executed, right? So how, what is the, how you can create the finally block? So here you need to use finally keyword, right? And within the finally keyword, you need to give the output here. Okay, so I will be giving the any output, right? The output for finally block. Finally block will be always executed. Irrespective of exception. Okay. So now you can see here, no exception is there, right? But you have added some finally block. Let's run it and let's see whether your finally block is executed or not. You can see if finally block is always executed. Sometimes we want to get, right, give some information that some exception has been triggered or not. There may be chances, right? So with the finally block we can find out that maybe there was a possibility of exception, but that was not triggered, right? Otherwise how you can find out, right, that there should be an exception? So that is the reason sometime we need to use finally block, so that we can get the information that at that point some exception can be triggered, and we already have the code. In case we are not having any code, so we have to write the code, right? And now in case some exception is there, suppose I want to get the ninth element, so definitely exception will be there, but still finally block will be executed. So that is the beauty of the finally block, right? You can see finally block is always executed. So in case exception is coming, and as now exception is coming, you can see the exception, right? Array index out of bound exception is coming, and finally block will be executed. Now in case suppose if you want to give the path 0, right, suppose if you want to get the 1 only, 0th index, it will be still finally block will be still executed, right? So though you are introing try and catch block, but in case there is no exception, so catch block part will be completely ignored. But with the help of finally block, we can get the information that there was a try catch block was there, right? So write no exception is not triggered, but there can be exception, so you can concentrate on that particular part, right, during coding. And in case exception is handled, next remaining line of code will be executed. But in case you are not handling the exceptions, your execution will be abrupt and you will be end at that point, and remaining line of code will be unexecuted or unattended, right? So that's all for today's session. Thank you.